Hi, I said I might make this video, especially if there was a fair bit of interest in the last one I made, and there was. There were quite a lot of comments, which from people who I enjoy interacting with, and if they're going to value that this, then that's great. There's been a lot of talk recently about community on the internet and freedom of speech. And the way things are set up, and all that sort of thing. And so, this video isn't made specifically for any one person or for any one thing, but all these sundry bits and pieces that I've seen have made me ponder about the nature of it and my knowledge or my experience of that over the years and the changes that have taken place. So I want to explore that, and some of this is going to be purely personal experience. Other parts of it is obviously going to be subjective because it's me that's observed it, but it's going to be more objective, not completely objective, observations of how the changes have impacted us and what opportunities and options that does and doesn't give us, and how we can learn to negotiate the sort of difficulties that we encounter of various kinds. This is likely to be quite lengthy, so what I will probably do, if I can, is put some time slots in the bottom of the various different things that I come up with, so that if you're not interested in certain aspects of it, you can skip them. And as ever with anything that I do, feedback or is valued, and exchange, communication between us, your perspective that might develop this whole thing is also more than welcome. I want to start by looking at the kind of historical basis on which the internet began, for me at least, and for many of us, I think, and how we interpreted that and how we negotiated that and how it led us forward. And I've been on the internet for sort of 14 years or thereabouts now, which is quite a lengthy period of time, but it's changed so much, and that's rare. We are in a technological age where things change at great speed, and often, when we might find it difficult to keep up because the changes are so rapid. But the internet itself has probably evolved more rapidly than any of us can adapt to, and perhaps have expectations and beliefs about it that aren't actually true or don't serve us. When I first came online, it was a free-for-all, pretty much. There were all sorts of very bizarre and interesting things going on. I mean, when I first came on, I thought, because of what I'd heard, I thought all I was going to find was porn, but that really wasn't the case. In fact, I'd steered clear of it, because I didn't want to just be beset with porn and the sort of associated viruses that would come through my computer because of that. I'm not against porn per se, but it just struck me as if that's all there is, then I'm not sure I want to bother. And that in itself is quite interesting, that that was its press at the time. And I wonder if part of that was to try and put people off using it at all. And back then, there were various things that were common to wherever you went, even though there were differences. That don't really exist in the same kind of way now. It was all forums or chat rooms, and so it was the opportunity to communicate with other people in text, And there were a couple that I joined. One was a BBC one, actually, which was quite interesting because it was, there was one part, there were two different aspects of it. One was, one was more of a sort of newsy type one, and one was a more explorative, creative type one. And the newsy one was very cutthroat, people being really quite objectionable towards one another. And the creative one was much more all-embracing and caring and explorative in a more imaginative kind of a way. So it was immediately apparent that these online venues that weren't actually physically real, because that felt quite odd initially, were very different. You know, that they each had a culture of its own, and that you chose what you got involved in, you know, your personal preference, your style, your interests, were catered for by how you chose the venues that you went to. I mean, I only ever went to one chat room, I think, and realised quite rapidly that had a very different atmosphere. I didn't like it very much, and it was quite heavily male-oriented at the time. But then I joined another one, which was a more philosophical, spiritual type of venue. And that was very interesting because there were certain hierarchies for a start, but it had a different type of person again. And and I learned a lot about the sort of abuses that can go on online, because the person that ran it was a very clever lunatic who liked to manipulate people, and who really did impose some quite serious abuses on younger members or more vulnerable members. And this became sort of gradually apparent. And I learnt at that time that how you ascertain what's actually going on online is quite different from the way you might ascertain it in the physical. The same signs aren't there for a start, obviously. You know, certainly back then, you know, now we still don't have the physical, but we often have visuals, though not always. And so you had to be boxed quite clever as to how to ascertain what was truly happening. I mean, back then, again, I don't do now because it got completely overwhelming. I used an instant messenger, and a lot of the people there came to me for support and help because of the difficulties that they were having, or just to befriend me. But that meant that when I turned the computer on, the screen would immediately fill with massive amounts of instant messenger boxes, because these people were in need of some kind of support or interaction. And so I became aware of sort of vulnerabilities that were going on out there, the neediness, the way manipulations were taking place, and that the way to put a stop to those was very different from the physical, from real life, very different, and required a different sort of patience. I know in life that one needs patience in order, you know, if you want to put a stop to anything, or you want to change the way that people are allowed to proceed through life when it's not actually illegal, but it's dreadful, that you need some kind of patience. But confrontation in real life is probably more beneficial than in an online venue. And I felt I needed to put a stop to this particular individual who was doing said endless harm through a kind of facade of great wisdom and philosophical encouragement and so on. And I succeeded. It took quite a while. But I did manage to put a stop to him and to help the many people that had been harmed, or to help them move in different directions. But that, and by in doing that, I ended up going somewhere else, which was a completely different ball game, and which suited me and fit my psyche like a glove, really, in that it was a place where very individualistic people wanted to share their perspective, their take on things, and they wanted to learn from one another. They wanted to benefit themselves through their explorations with other people. And it was very robust. You could have quite sparky conversations, quite robust conversations, but there were never any sides taken. Never. People would come in expecting there to be sides taken. But if they were going to hang about, they would fairly quickly realise that everybody was quite comfortable in their own skin, and that this wasn't a kind of swashbuckling, I'm going to knock you down type of a place, or that I want to prove myself right and you wrong, that simply wasn't relevant. And that again was an extremely valuable tool to learn how to operate on the internet. And back then, throughout that period, with the various different places I encountered, and there were others as well, of people who I still know now, who I would almost consider my online family, but just something relevant to cite here, was the free-for-all nature of it. That if you put something out there on the internet, it was fair game, because you could take other people's stuff. So if you put images or original work or ideas or whatever out there, you were sharing it with the world. And if the world chose to help itself to it, then it could. And that, in that sense, it seemed utopian, in that there was no business involved. There was no money exchanging hands. There was a free sharing of material, of insights, of creativity. And whilst there were perhaps attendant issues with the chaos that brought, and that you encountered some truly bizarre people, well, I mean, that hasn't really changed, has it? That utopian sense of true sharing was hugely valuable. And the shift, when that shift came, when business realised the massive amounts of money that it could make out of the internet, was when it kind of didn't start to die, but it began to turn more into the societies, the real societies that we live in that people were carving things up and defining what they possessed and what was belonged to somebody else, and charging for it, and defining what you could and couldn't do, and making a big fuss about material that was owned or copyrighted. And that in some ways I think that was when it changed from something that was truly wonderful to something that was much more of a mixed blessing. But the realization, some of the realizations that I had during the halcyon days of the internet, were that it was very curious how what you saw on a screen, even if it was in text from somebody that you didn't, who you didn't know who they were, you didn't know what age they were, you didn't know what they looked like, you didn't know what experience they had, you knew nothing about them really, other than those words, and they stood on or fell on the words that they shared. But, and you know, there was no status, you had to build a status for yourself. If you had any credibility at all, it was because you'd built it online. You could not bring your real life qualifications or experience to bear, because it didn't wash. And I think that was a good thing. I think that was a really valuable thing. But what you saw somehow, and that's still the case, it seems, what you saw somehow got directly into your psyche. It almost bypassed your conscious mind. So that whilst you were reading the words and taking in the content of the words, any emotional barbs or any insecurities that you might have, or any sort of underlying issues that you had, were immediately and easily accessed by whatever you were looking at, whether intentionally or no by the person. You know, people back then didn't tend to play each other in such a conscious way as they probably do now, but there was some conscious manipulations going on, and that again was a very valuable insight, because that still exists. And the sort of wranglings that people have now are often either based on this sort of like tribalism that seems to have evolved more recently. That wasn't necessarily the case in the early days, and I find it very bizarre, and I don't understand it, and I don't think it serves any real purpose. I think it's self-defeating. Or it buys into one's sort of insecurities and tendencies to lash out, or to read things in a particular way, to interpret things in light of past experience. Even if that person knows nothing about you, you may well assume that it's speaking to that particular aspect of you, or alternatively, that we can make gross and ridiculous assumptions about people which are so way off the mark as to be laughable. Like, you know, only the other day, in fact, I was accused of being a Muslim simply because I didn't automatically agree with something that was anti-Muslim. You know, people make these very snap judgments, and they probably do that in real life anyway, but I think it's much, much easier to do on the internet. So what I'm trying to say, I think, is that I learnt that there were subtle and sometimes not so subtle differences in how we interact online and how we interpret what we see online, and how much more easy it is for our emotional selves to be accessed, and for our history and for our unconscious selves to be accessed through what we see or hear online than it is in the flesh. We have the physical barrier of our body and how we interpret body language and context in the physical in ways that we simply don't get online. So we need to develop and understand and make good use of those differences and how we perceive that. So moving on now to YouTube, which was very different back in the day and mimicked, I suppose, more what I have already attempted to describe about the early days, in that it was more of a free-for-all. YouTube itself didn't actively encourage us to play that free-for-all that the internet used to be, but it certainly didn't try and stop it. So there was much fun to be had and much pleasure to be had in sharing all these very different things and plagiarizing is the wrong word, but kind of using other material to put together to make things more interesting. And again, it was more of a kind of anarchic, chaotic, joyful free-for-all. And the moment big business started to clamp down on that, it changed. But that wasn't the fault of YouTube itself. It was YouTube is built on very wobbly foundations anyway, because I don't think it ever anticipated getting as big as it has, nor did it obviously in the early days anticipate being taken over by Google. But I wouldn't necessarily pin that down to it being those specific organisations. I would pin it down more to the nature of the change of the internet organisations, whether it be political organisations, social organisations, or business organisations, sticking their oar in and getting involved, or whether it's the fact that you reach a critical mass of people so that there are enough people who are going to abuse a system as much as there are to try and make money out of a system, that suddenly you have to start clamping down on that system and making it operate in a particular way. But the human psyche is not geared up to this. So there's a lot of flailing around goes on from all sides. And so business itself doesn't do what it does in an organized, structured manner. And business has always been manipulative, always. Society is manipulative. People bang on about religion being manipulative, but that's just another organization. They all do it in order to try, not that I approve, but in order to try and make things manageable and copeable with. So I think blaming Google or blaming whatever for the way things are is fairly unhelpful, really, as is suggesting very much to them. I think they do take straw polls of what's out there, but they don't take much advice. However, when one looks at somewhere like YouTube, you can see that there are numerous different ways in which one can operate here. You can go down the route of it being your career and of money making and doing what YouTube or Google suggests you do in order to make money and to create a kind of more commercial face for yourself. And that's one way of doing it. And it's not a way that I would ever choose to go down, but it is the way that some choose to go down, and that's up to them if that's what they want to do. But there is no way that that's the only way to do it. And I'm sure that Google are well aware of that. It's the way that they're going to encourage, because it's the way that they make the most money themselves. But there are so many, there is a complex melee of different types of action going on, from the tiniest person just putting stuff out there that nobody really watches to the people who get millions of views, to the people who just like to talk and don't want to make money out of it, and Also in comments, there are people who approach commenting and exchange and interaction and communication and community, if you can even call it that. You know, massive amounts of ways. We come from not quite all, but nearly all the different cultures in the world with our very different perceptions and takes on how things operate. And we simply cannot expect it there to become a homogenized way of approaching this or a way of being any more, actually, than we can expect everybody to be interested in the same things in our society or to behave in ways that we consider appropriate or that we approve of. There will inevitably be people in our communities, our physical communities, that we don't like, that we don't get on with, that we may have come to blows with, or that we just avoid because we don't like them or we don't approve of them, or we just don't have anything in common. And that's going to be true here as well. And who we choose to interact with and how we choose to interact with them is up to us. It's not up to that organisation to paternalistically make it work for us or to make it all... I mean, I would hate it if it were all homogenised and forcing us to behave in exactly the same way towards each other or for everything to be exactly the way I wanted it to be. That there is a challenge in it, that there are lots of different people ranging from, you know, the youngest of the young to the nearly dropping off the other end, from people from all different walks of life, from wealthy people to people who have next to nothing, people with mental health issues, people with learning difficulties, people who have all sorts of different political beliefs, who have philosophical differences. You know, isn't that the joy of it? And all any organisation can do is set it up in the best way they can, which is all inevitably going to be flawed and to fall down in various different ways, so that there are ways that we can express ourselves, ways that we can communicate, and sort of ways that we can vaguely protect ourselves if things get really, really difficult. And they have worked their way towards that, not entirely successfully, but it's difficult to do. So I think there is an art to interacting online. And I have been largely delighted at the fact that I have been able to interact with an incredibly diverse range of people, and sometimes with some really difficult people. I mean, I've failed once or twice, and you have to accept that, don't you? That's just life. There's always someone that you're just not going to get along with, however hard you try. But I have had people coming and trolling me in the past and going out of their way to make things really difficult. And I've seen it as a challenge to try and make friends with them, or to try and find points of contact, to try and engage. And it's been difficult. And sometimes you just said you just can't, you know, and you have to accept that and concede that and move on. But actually, to do that, rather than to just dismiss people who don't behave like you or don't behave in ways you like, or who won't conform to your particular preferred format, to find ways of engaging with people like that is where we learn the most, surely, about life, about ourselves, about all sorts of different things. So I think, you know, if we limit ourselves too much and we stick to what we like too much, or we stick to our little tribes too much, or our, you know, sense of what is right and what isn't, then I think we fail to take up some of the wonderful opportunities that the internet can offer. And I've gone on, and I will stop there. And you know, any feedback, there's probably loads of stuff I haven't said, but that's just what came out. So yeah, feedback or thoughts or development of this would be gratefully received. Thank you.